Good morning. Good morning for those of you that are with us this already. Thank you. Have a cup of coffee or dig into your lunch. We're going to get started in a minute. Less than a minute. We've got some great guests with us today, and we're glad you're with us live. Don't forget, the Q&A is available both on Facebook Live and here for those of us that are joining us in the Zoom. Well, here we are. Good morning. Good morning. How is everyone this morning? I just cut the music off and just said, let's get to it, right?
Yeah, I was a little nervous. I didn't know if my mic.
I know. Sometimes I hit the, I'm not the best with the Zoom technology. And when I hit stop share a little too early, but it is what it is. Well, good to see you all today. Bob, Repass, Jorge Newbery are here, and we will be joined very shortly by our busy friend, Dave Gordon of Arc Companies, who just texted me that he's on a, getting off a call shortly. Oh, he says, can you hear me? Oh, he says he's on. Hold on one second. Where? I do not hear you, David. Are you on the panelist link? Okay, well, maybe he'll figure that out and join us soon. Okay, so Bill by Mel here, another episode of the Win-Win webinar series. It's just after noon on October 12th, 2021. And about once a quarter, I like to get together the good old boys, gentlemen that I have worked with for, I would say at least a decade now. I would say some gentlemen like Bob Repass, you've got years of experience over me, but Jorge and I kind of, I feel like we kind of came up as children in the business together.
Toddlers.
Yeah, exactly. So let me give you each a chance to introduce yourself. Take a minute, introduce yourself, your company, what you're up to. Bob, why don't you start? Get us started.
Yeah, Bill, I don't know if you were trying to say I was the oldest one on the panel here or what, but I'll go ahead and own up to that. I appreciate you having me on here. I'm Bob Repass, Managing Director of Colonial Funding Group and our family of companies, which includes No School and Colonial Capital Management and our Colonial Impact Fund. And our fund is actively buying performing, non-performing, and reperforming loans. And we also buy mom and pop seller finance loans. I've been in the seller finance space since 1990. Obviously evolved through the 08-09 crisis and got more into the NPL space and along with the loan servicing space for a while when I was at Bayview. So I can feel George's pain running a servicing operation there. but now we are looking forward to what's coming up in the market as we wrap up 2021 and head into 2022. So thanks again for having me.
Oh, that's great, kids. I'm very glad to have you. And another, I'll do a little shameless plug for you because I'm proud of you for not making it yourself. You'll notice the little note expo over Bob's shoulder. He's been an influential part of Note Expo. The creation of this event every November in Dallas, and they actually are doing a live event in just a few weeks, in the first week of November, and we'll get a chance to let you kind of remind people of that in a minute. Meanwhile, I will turn it over to Dave, to Jorge, to introduce himself while I work on getting Dave his his correct link. Go ahead, Jorge.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Bill. I'm glad to be here. So Jorge Newbery, founder of American Homeowner Preservation, which started in 2008 and morphed into a fund which has purchased more than 10,000 defaulted mortgages over the last decade. We've also involved in several ancillary businesses. We have AHP Servicing, AHP Title Company, which is a title insurance company, America's Trustee Services, and Activist Legal. And finally, Pre-REO, which I think is probably most helpful to your audience. Pre-REO is two things. It's a marketplace for non-performing mortgages. There's hundreds of non-performing mortgages, typically from institutional sellers that are available on our site for purchase one by one to smaller mid-sized investors. And we finance NPL, both non-performing mortgages, which are sourced on the Pre-REO platform, and non-performing mortgages that are sourced off the Pre-REO platform. We provide 75% financing on all of them. That's available now. If you go to pre-REO.com, you can learn more. And finally, all our businesses have been powered by crowdfunding. We have raised more than $130 million from crowdfunding. Pre-REO is currently raising money at 7%. We pay out investors 7%. It's open to accredited and non-accredited investors with minimum investment as of only $100, making it accessible to just about anybody. And finally, AHP Title has also just launched its crowdfunding raise as of yesterday. Same terms, 7%, minimum investment, $100. We're looking to raise $150 million into each of Pre-REO and AHP Title. I'll keep going because Bill's on the phone. So
I thought we all knew Zoom by now. Maybe it's my fault. You know, I probably did something.
No, I'll confess. I did the same thing as Dave. And I just realized it at the last minute when I realized no one else was joining. So that was it.
Oh, was it maybe an old panelist link or something like that? Maybe.
If you went down in the email, you're looking for something to click onto. I clicked onto it. It just says, hey, waiting for the webinar to start. And then I realized, wait, I'm supposed to be on the webinar. So right.
I think there's a difference because you guys are also always, you guys are participants when you're not panelists. So sometimes the links I've had that issue. But I'm sure that Dave Gordon is going to figure it out and be with us in a minute. In the meantime, let's just get things started. I'm usually Mr., you know, poo-poo, you know, the dark clouds are coming. And, you know, it's kind of my nature to always try to be contrarian. And it's so hard, though, in this situation, when you're a seller, to not really be in awe of, you know, what's happening to us on the liquidation side for those of us that do have assets to sell. So why don't we start with that? And I'm going to kick it back to you, George. I mean, you founded Pre-REO. It was almost like, I mean, I don't know, you know, when I love you and I talk about the idea when you first had it a few years ago, I thought it was brilliant. I didn't think you'd pull it off. I knew it was a space that didn't exist. And I mean, I was like, how would you, you know, I mean, it was like, you know, crazy. And there it is. You know, now you've got, it's part of what's fueling this hot real estate market. Tell me what you're experiencing, not just from the pre-REO perspective, but also managing your own portfolio. And then Bob, if you could follow up with that.
Sure. I mean, the market is red hot. I mean, that's like stating the obvious. You can read that in USA Today. But from the note perspective, we are selling loans at just prices that are extraordinary to me. I mean, we're all relative old timers. So we've seen the days when we used to sell performing mortgages for like 60, 65 cents. And that was like, oh, that's pretty good. Now we're getting, you know, we're selling typically over 90 cents on almost all of our performing mortgages, land contracts a little bit cheaper. And I thought I was doing pretty good at 90, 92 cents is where most of our sales are coming up. I was at a ABS conference last week and I was talking to a fellow fund manager. He was saying, oh, we just sold ours. It was almost the same stuff at 102. So just over par. And he said, and even those with compliance issues. Now the difference is we're selling like 10 million at a time. He's selling a quarter billion at a time. And it's this odd situation where, which I think is helpful for everyone to recognize and acknowledge that when you're selling a performing loan, the best buyer is going to be an institutional buyer. And the bigger the pool it's in, the better the pricing for all the loans in that pool. And then the opposite is true in my mind for NPL, where the best buyer is the local real estate investor who is very comfortable taking back the property. That's what it comes to. And they're willing to pay a little bit more than the fund who is going to have to realize, hey, you know, we're going to have to do prop pres. We're going to have to eventually pay a broker to sell this. So local investors are willing to pay more. So I think that's something that we should all acknowledge. And that, in fact, that's what we're doing at Pre-REO. We've had some Pre-REO. So Pre-REO is a marketplace for non-performing mortgages. Some of them go REO, but some of them also modify. And, you know, we have these local investors saying, you know, I don't want to mod. I'm going to get payments for the next 20 years. That's like, I just want to like make a profit and then do it again, not sit around and collect payments for 20 years. And so I kind of educate those investors that, hey, it could go either way. And we have to get your permission to accept a mod, but I encourage people to take mods because if they don't, And that that homeowner really wants to stay in the home. They'll get an attorney. You'll be paying legal fees. They'll be paying legal fees, and no one wins. And the mod, you can still win. You can, and now you as a local investor selling one performing loan, you're not going to sell it to a big fund for optimal pricing. So what we're doing is we're offering smaller investors, hey, bring us your performing loans, your reperforming loans. We'll offer them out in large pools. And that's how you get optimum pricing, at least optimum for us, you know, 10 to $20 million pools, as opposed to, you know, I guess some guys are doing $250 million pools. I can't quite do that, but they're probably not going to take the one extra loan or the 10 extra loans. So we do that. And that will probably pick up 5 to 10 cents. And then I'm telling the institutions, if you sell it to local investors, when it's a non-performer, you'll probably pick up 5 to 10 cents. So that's kind of in my mind, how it's working. That all said, as in terms of us as a buyer, we're on the sidelines as a buyer ourselves, and we just ordered about 1,200 BPOs about a week ago, and our goal is to sell every asset in our portfolio, everything that's not on an organic pathway towards a liquidation in the next several months. I am concerned that fast forward 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, at some point we're going to look back and say, fourth quarter 2021 or first quarter 2022, second quarter 2022, somewhere in that period is probably the peak. And I'm okay getting out a little bit early. I don't want to get out a little bit late, where I'm saying, if only we sold 3 months ago, I'd have picked up 10 points or something like that. So that's what's going through my mind. I think it's an optimal time to sell. That's what we're doing. But you know, for those note investors who are in the audience, I think there's definitely the one-offs MPL deals. There's definitely available. I mean, whether it's on pre-REO or note or Bob's platform, you know, if you find the deal, we can finance it no matter where you find it. But those I think are good, good sources. And and what I tell kind of, you know, newer note buyers is, buy some notes now. That's absolutely the best way you're going to learn this business, and then be ready for that downturn. Because when this thing goes the other direction, 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, then there should be massive opportunities. And that's where, you know, there's real transfers of wealth. But you don't want to be, hey, I'm ready to go when the downturn's happening, because it's going to be tough to kind of get things going when you haven't done it before. Right. And I'll final foot on this one. You know, we started this business started buying notes just over 10 years ago, and defaulted notes. And that was a market in a massive downturn where there were more sellers than buyers. And we were able to, within 6 months of starting this, we were able to buy from FDIC, Citibank, from some of the biggest banks in the country. And that was only because there were so few buyers compared to sellers. It's completely changed. Some of those people won't even talk to us anymore because we're too small, and we're really a lot bigger. Right. It is funny how it works. But back then, everybody would sell to you just because they were desperate to get rid of stuff. That's coming again. I'm hoping that pre-REO will be a platform to be in the middle of all that. And I get to move so people can actually see our logo. And so that is those are my thoughts. But it's a fascinating market. And I do say I'm in awe. I mean, the REO, what we're selling REO for, what we're selling notes for, and what everyone else is just astounding prices.
Well, and before
you guys hear me?
Hey, David.
Hey,
technology works.
So turn your camera on and join us. Where are you?
Hold on. You're asking for the non-technology guy here.
Dave. It's great to hear you. You're like God.
I don't know where it's like Jesus coming to fruition, the Jewish Jesus over here. I'm kidding. I don't know where the video thing is on this, on your connections.
Are you on a iPad or on a... let me see if there's a way that I can do this.
You guys can hear me now?
Oh, yeah, we can hear you. Now,
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't see. Okay, well, we see you there, and we hear you. So now I put your cute picture with sunglasses up to join us.
Oh, wow. Wow, that's my model shot.
Well, you know, first of all, you touched on so much, George, that I'm going to come back to it. And then Bob, has a follow-up. But Dave, why don't you just take a minute and introduce yourself before we go on?
My name is David Gordon. I run a fund called ARC. We have offices in Miami, Florida, Panama, the country, and New York City. We're focused on distressed real estate, both commercial and residential, first and second lien mortgages, both commercial and residential. We've probably been one of the larger buyers of distressed seconds over the past 2 or 3 years. Before that, I was at Morgan Stanley on the trading desk till 2008. Have a firm, this firm now, and you know, happy as can be.
Yeah, and a little new child, and well, newish, I guess.
He's gonna get the my $1 empire one day.
Well, great to have you with. I'm going to try one more thing before we move on here, which is to promote you to panelist again. See if you can accept that. That might
join as panelist.
There you go. Now you can probably do the video, possibly. But you know, panelist. Either way, you're here.
Okay, how's your kid, Dave?
My kid is 15 months old. I'm trying to get him to do some labor already, but he won't work yet. So
I have two 13 month olds, so just okay. Right behind you.
So we both started late in life, it looks like. So
yeah,
we're both getting a lot more gray hairs lately. I don't look exactly. Like I do with those sunglasses anymore, I promise you that.
So. Wow,
great. Okay, well, there you go. So let's get back to what we were talking about, because people are probably not as interested in our children, even though I might be. First of all, we're talking about the red hot real estate market, and I'll lead in with my own story of, you know, last week we had a property we put on the market in Pensacola on the Panhandle. I was ready to take a full payoff of that loan for like $115,000, $120,000 right at the start before COVID hit. And we ended up putting the third party deed rat did not take our deal. Oh, hey, there he is.
It all comes together. It's your technology side. So now okay, it's all together great. On the bottom.
Beautiful. Sorry, great to have you with us. Okay. Looking thanks, good, Bill. Dave. okay. So I'm telling you about this Pensacola property. I thought it was worth $120,000 2 years ago. We put it on the market for $180,000. Within a week, we've got 10 offers and we're already well above $200,000. And and I can tell you every month I have multiple stories like that, not just in Florida, but in other parts of the country as well. You know, obviously it is a crazy market. And to follow up with what George said, those of us that have assets to sell are really concerned that this kind of the speed, or at least that's my perspective, you know, 2% per month increases in value are not going to sustain, and it may not end well. Bob, shoot to you. what's your thoughts on the market now?
Well, first of all, George gave a lot to unpack there. So let's try to dig through some of that. Obviously the market is on fire in most places, right? But sometimes people kind of, they'll get drunk on the headlines, right? They'll think every market everywhere is just multiple offers all over list price. Everything's going up, 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 and up. And there's always going to be areas throughout the country where real estate's either flat or appreciating at a slower pace than some of these headline markets that you hear about. So one point that George made that I wanted to expound on was, you know, keeping people in their home. You know, the home ownership part, the modifications, the forbearance plans. A lot of people get into the MPL space and, you know, hey, I'm going to get the property back. I'm going to make a big profit. I'm going to sell it for four times what it's worth, you know, and it's only going to take me 30 days and, I'm going to make all this money. And really that may happen on an asset by asset base. But if you're in the MPL space on the long haul, I mean, you've got to look at the workout resolution model. And I know you talk a lot about that, Bill. But I think we're all passionate about keeping people in their homes, right? I mean, we've all been in this business long enough to know that affordable home ownership is what it's about. And, that's what we try to do at Colonial. We deal mostly in comparison to what George talked about on his model, the smaller investors, people looking for one-off investments, maybe small pools, a dozen assets or less. We're not buying, you know, $10 million transactions. We're focusing on the smaller deals. We do have an online platform, Notes Direct, where people can find performing, reperforming, and non-performing loans, you know, in an online marketplace. So that's how we move a lot of assets. But we think that the flow of inventory, look, one thing people forget is there was millions of loans that were delinquent prior to COVID, right? Somewhere between 3 and 5 million loans, you know, whatever the number happens to be, they were already delinquent. They got a reprieve, so to speak, from COVID, forbearance, foreclosure moratoriums, et cetera. So that, now we refer to those as legacy, even though they're really only a couple of years old. But that's what's going to hit the marketplace pretty quick. And then we'll get through the ones that get, you know, didn't work out, the forbearance or the workout in the next batch. So right. I think we're going to see, it's already starting. I know Fannie and Freddie both announced sales coming up in Q4. So we're going to start seeing a lot of these loans hit the market. And one thing I like, you mentioned earlier, Bill, all of us kind of work together. I mean, we're not really competitors. We're counterparties. Right. We do trades on both the buy and sell side, depending on what our capital situation is. Do we need to deploy some? Do we need to sell some, liquidate some, and so forth? So,
yeah,
looking forward.
It's interesting that, and you know, when we speak to it, you bring up so many good points there. When when I speak to limited partners or people that want to come in and invest with us, you know, there's this constant conversation about, well, wait a second, you've done deals with these guys, you don't do deals with, is this your friend? Is this your business partner? Are you buying from them? Are you selling to them? You know, I did a deal in, we all do it back and forth because we have stuff on our books that you can create value in and you're on your side, buying in at the, you know, at whatever percentage or whatever the condition of the asset is. And it's really, and the same is true on the institutional level. I mean, even our relationships with, you know, the bigger boys that we're drawing stuff down from, the Bayviews and the Carringtons and the, you know, the PRPs of the world, we all work together buying and selling stuff. It's an interesting thing, the way this industry works in that regard. And you make a very good point that there was already a ton of foreclosures that were nearing the finish line. Where I found my value when we started First Lien Capital this year was in buying the stuff that was really at the finish line in judicial states that had then gotten shut down by the moratorium, states like New York or whatnot. And you just had such a, those owners that were counting on liquidations in 2020, you know, at the point of where early 2021 rolled around, I was able to come in and take out some good opportunities. I also want to go back to what George said about the believe it or not, the traditional way to liquidate stuff is performing stuff yet in a large pool to institutional buyers. In larger pools demands higher numbers than performing stuff to individual small investors. And the reverse is true when you get into the NPL space. Guys like us that are managers are looking for an extra discount, whereas I can take a small property that I maybe pay, you know, 40 or 50 cents of UPB on in a state, find an individual investor in that state that to them paying 70% of UPB is a huge home run. They're going for the asset, and I can make a quick 30% return. So that was a very interesting piece of information that I did not want to step over. And I think, George, you gave away a little secret there.
No, but it's, I mean, and then people should never worry. What you just mentioned, hey, I'm selling it, I made a 30% return. No one should begrudge you for that if it's a good price for the local guy, because a local person, you know, especially people that are transitioning from being REO investors who are paying, you know, 100% of REO price, all of a sudden they're paying 75% of the REO price in an appreciating market. And usually our BPOs are at least a few months old. So in this kind of environment, things have probably gone up. I mean, everybody's benefiting from that today. That will go the other direction. We should all remember, you know, when we used to factor in fades into our bids, now we factor in, you know, HPA. Yeah, which is It's the time of times, but don't forget, fades are coming back. We just don't know exactly when, but they're on their way back. But I agree. Yeah. It's an odd, you know, we're trying to make a business out of being the conduit, the conduit for the smaller investor with a reperforming loan to sell it up into an institution. Your last two sales to institutions came, you know, the funds were backed by Goldman Sachs because we got the wires from Goldman Sachs. So we, those are the guys who are going to pay the best. And then, but those same buyers are selling their MPL through pre-REO because they're going to, it's taking it, just being the conduit for the loans going back and forth, reperformers up to the institutions, NPLs out of the institutions. And that's
and you're really providing the access to individual investors that has never existed before to buy single asset NPLs with financing, which is a whole nother conversation we'll get into. Before that, I want to ask Dave, what's your experience with this market? What are you guys doing? Are you liquidating? Are you trying to sell as quickly as possible? Talk to me about your experience, and especially being in South Florida, you're probably seeing the craziest of the crazy, you know, right?
That's a really good question. So my levered returns, let's talk about returns. You know, we're targeting about an 18% levered return with our leverage, which includes some of the securitizations work we're doing. So if we get to the 30s, that's great. And I think with some of the price appreciation, we're getting there. But from a risk adjusted basis, with leverage, we're at about, you know, kind of 18% is our target, a little lower than some of the other funds, institutional funds. You know, you mentioned Bayview and Carrington. From an unlevered perspective, they're targeting about, you know, 6 to 6.5%. With their leverage, they're probably at the same number, maybe a little bit less than us, but they're also targeting the, you know, $50 and $100 million pools that go straight to securitization. You know, my typical target is 5 to 20 million, which is the ones that the Carringtons and the Bayviews ignore. I'm also targeting seconds, which I can do a little bit more work on. But in the sense of liquidation, you know, we've done a lot of modifications with loan, with values going up. You know, we're a national firm, but we've had a lot of mods that we've done recently. We're doing a $300 million securitization we're working on right now, which will close in right before Thanksgiving, maybe right after. We're finishing the valuation on that's being led by an investment bank. But it's amazing the numbers I'm getting for that securitization with us keeping the B tranche, where things are trading for. And that takes a lot of risk off my the table, but it also gets me to the same yield hurdles I was getting to before and keeps the assets under us managing it. The difference between us, I think us and a Bayview and a Carrington, while they're targeting those larger pools, we can play in that $5 to $20 million space very, very well. And yes, from time to time, I will look at some of these larger pools, but it's really hard to participate in those. My bucket's a little less competitive, although it's competitive, but we think we're a good target bid. And I believe a lot of guys who are selling, they're looking, even though my price might be 1 or 2 points, maybe back of their best bid, they want to know in terms of execution, people will execute. And that's what we've been very good at. We're not really good at selling one-off and onesie-twosie assets. It becomes cost inefficient to us. The only thing we've done that with is some contract for deeds. We kind of played in that space. I think actually we listed some with you, Bob, and this is going back about a year ago. I think, don't quote me on that. But you know, price appreciation is not my model. Although we are seeing price appreciation, you know, Bill, you mentioned the Florida market specifically, we're going to see throughout the Sun Belt somewhat of a correction. It's not going to be 2008. Yeah. The correction is going to be more like 5 or 10% because the difference is people were lending at 120 LTV back then. Now they're lending at, you know, 75 to 80 max. So there's real money at risk. So I don't think the correction is going to be 5 to 10% as interest rates climb. And I believe you'll start seeing that in 2022. You have to. It's time. With that in mind, I think we've put that all into our models, and I'm pricing things based off that. I also think my last point is, you know, forbearances. you know, one of the things that we've put a lot more mile is the forbearances. And, you know, and I believe, especially in states like New York, the forbearance timeline is going to be extended throughout the beginning of 2022. So there's a big deviation right now between sellers and buyers of when that forbearance really will end. It'll be interesting to see when those losses to some extent for some of the banks on the forbearances will be taken. It's up to right now, it hasn't been.
Mm-hmm. And when you're liquidating your portfolio, are you reperforming the largest portion of it, and or are you actually taking stuff to REO? Or, you know, what's kind of your breakdown of?
I would say a mix between both. On the second sides, we're modifying them and selling them. I mean, we're getting numbers that I've never heard of before on the seconds that are modified. We're getting numbers of, you know, stuff that's just a tiny tad bit below 100 LTV. We're getting numbers in the 90s. Wow. So from large institutional buyers, I think George mentioned Goldman Sachs. But numbers that I've never been heard of before, especially when you're selling in large, large pools, again, over that $30 million mark. And we'll buy those smaller pools to get to those levels, modifying them and sell them out. So that's been very good for us.
Where's their cash coming from to buy that? Is that just leverage and securitized cash?
It's leverage and going directly to securitization. If they don't have the borrower, you got to remember the bond market is so tight right now. I mean, people are buying A pieces for less than 3%. You got to remember banks financing right now is under a half a basis point.
Yep.
So if someone's seeing a 3% return for a quote unquote 3-year bond, it makes a lot of sense from a bank and or a quote unquote REIT institutional investor. But I'm using Goldman as an example, but you mentioned Goldman, but Goldman's using that as they have the money, they're going to do a securitization immediately, and it wraps right into who the investor is, whether it be an insurance company or a bank is in the eye of the beholder. But there is a ton of money in that space, desperate for real yield at low LTVs. So,
right.
I hope I answered your question. If I was long-winded, I apologize.
No, this is all good stuff, and it continues. I want to get back into the conversation about forbearances and modifications and dig a little deeper there. Let's start with, well, first of all, I want to ask each of you, and you know, who you service with. Obviously, I know who George services with, but who are your various servicers that you work with other than AHP, and how much are your decisions on whether to forbear or modify following? Are you following the servicer's guidelines that are following the GSE recommendations? Are you listening to CFPB? Actually, let's start with George, since you actually talk to the CFPB probably too much, right?
We do streamline mods. I mean, most of our loans are privately owned. They're not government backed. And so we don't have the same requirements. It's lots of times dictated by the investor. Again, we do encourage all our investors to accept mods, either accept them as is per underwriting or counter them. Don't just deny them. I think that's a bad, that oftentimes will give rise to bad things. Yeah. So provided they can qualify for it, try to make a deal. But these, we try to do streamline mods. I mean, we can't, this thing about going back and forth, getting tax returns, paycheck stubs, hardship letters, and stuff like that. I mean, if it's government backed, you have no choice. But if it's not, it really is oftentimes an impediment. People, I didn't file my taxes. You know, I work under the table. There's all kinds of reasons you can do with stated income mods. And these things need to push through. And you want to see, hey, is this person going to perform or not going to perform, and kind of get there, as opposed to, you know, taking 3 or 4 months to gather everything and then all the stars align and all of a sudden you can proceed with a mod. So if someone wants a mod, we try to do it on a streamlined basis, provided the investors are good with that. Mm-hmm.
And just talking about it with regard to the pre-REO side again, because you've got, so what's happening is you're going out and financing, you know, a portion, a majority of the purchase price of NPL. You have a private investor that comes in as first loss capital, but then keeps all the upside. And I have personally witnessed some of your investors make a lot of money on deals. I will. That's your little plug for the day, George.
I appreciate that.
Now, the flip side to that is since a borrower is buying, I mean, since the buyer is buying an NPL, there is a real possibility that the borrower asks for and is qualified for modification. How do you bring an investor over that? How do you get them to see the perspective on modifying when they were really coming in to try to get the real estate?
Yeah, here's my message to them is, hey, if you buy five of these, chances are you're probably get to foreclosure on half of them, probably even three out of the five. But on the others, you need to be ready for a mod or some other types of, you know, could also be deed in lieu or short sale or something like that. But you need to be prepared for a mod and realize that that's earning a good return and modifying a homeowner and keeping that family in their home are not mutually exclusive. You can modify them, hold that loan for at this point for 6 months. If the family makes 6 months payments on time, there's a mark, you can sell that loan today for a significant premium over what you paid for it as an NPL. And I think that's the message. And okay, you're not going to make quite as much as if you got an REO, but you're going to make a lot more than if the homeowner gets an attorney and drags out the foreclosure for the next 3 years. So take a decent gain, recycle the money and do it again. And if the homeowner falters, they do the mod, they can't sustain it and they stop making payments again. Okay, then don't do a mod the next time. And they get delegated authority. So all the investors, I mean, they have delegated authority to make the decision. So ultimately they're the ones that make the decision, but if they make a bad decision, it's bad for us and it's bad for them. We want them to succeed. We want them to pay off our financing. So to the extent, we do provide them guidance and we have had a number of investors accept mods. And in this next pool that we're putting out a performing loan pool in the next couple of weeks. And there's a number of pre-REO loans in there. And I see investors who bought them at 75 cents. My expectation is they're going to enter at 90. Plus they picked up a down payment. Plus they picked up several payments in the interim. They're going to be making some pretty good returns. Maybe not the same as if they had an REO, but it's still a good return.
Very nice. And Bob, could you follow up on your approach to forbearance? And then the second thing I'd like you to speak about is follow up on the seconds, your take on the seconds market. As Dave obviously has pointed out, the seconds seem to be on fire. I'd just like to hear, that's also a big market for you, right, Bob?
Actually, we don't really buy a whole lot of seconds. Oh. We've bought a handful whenever they're in a pool that we're buying of a mixed pool.
Bob, sell them to me.
There you go. And to follow up on, obviously from our perspective as the fund manager managing our fund is to do as many mods as we can, right? So we're looking, just like George, at streamlined mods. We have, private mortgages. They're not backed by the government or anything. We try to make it as seamless as we can for the borrower to stay in the property. We basically use two servicers. We use Security National, SN Servicing, and we use FCI. So right now with the forbearance, really, we didn't get hit too hard with a lot of people entering forbearance plan. It was a less of a percentage than we anticipated. Mm-hmm. But we've done quite a few mods to keep people in their homes. And it's been relatively painless, so to speak. To George's point of getting tax returns and pay histories and going through all that, we didn't, the state of the income, we pretty much, if they had a desire to stay in the property and the ability to repay, and we wanted to make it work. And the way the market is, we season them up for 6 months mm-hmm. plus or whatever, and you can sell them and you still come out pretty nice. Borrower stays in the home. The end investor gets a good, solid cash flowing deal and everybody's happy. So that's kind of been our model there. But as far as the seconds, like I said, we've probably owned a couple dozen. And that's only been, just through acquisitions of a big take it or leave it all in pool.
Mm-hmm. Great. By the way, just as a reminder to our audience, we've got about 15 minutes left. If you have any questions that you'd like the panelists to answer, whether you're watching on Facebook Live, you can put them in the chat. We do have someone to communicate those to us. And if you're here in the Zoom room, the Q&A button to the right of the raise hand button is where you would put any questions you'd like to ask the four of us. We take a similar approach to our forbearances and our, to the certain extent, our main servicer is Planet Home. I've had loans with AHP and then experience with SN and FCI as well. George,
and you, AHP.
Yes, I said AHP.
Oh, right? I did. I missed that.
Of course. The Planet is a little bit more like, wants to follow the institutional route, right? Which is make sure that there's acknowledgement letters and that the borrower knows they have 30, the 30-day timeline that they have to respond, et cetera. So we're kind of somewhere in between a streamline and trying to follow, the general guidance that the GSEs are kind of pushing on. Even the private and a lot of the private investors, and I'd like to hear, Dave, your take on this is, there's some consideration. It's very interesting though, because I was at a conference last week, and it was mostly banks and general counsels of banks in the special assets groups and institutional investors. And it's just really interesting to hear how, like, we talk about what's best for the borrower, and we talk about how can we work with the borrower, let's streamline and whatever. And, when you get a bunch of attorneys for banks together, the conversation is, how do we protect the bank? And it's really just so interesting because, I raise my hand, ask questions like, how can we, how are you guys doing streamlines and whatnot? It was like speaking a different language, and there's just so much fear of the CFPB and the local and state municipalities now that you understand why mortgage servicing becomes a clunky business and with full of inefficiencies. And it really is setting us up for another windfall of opportunity, because we all know that in addition to the several million of defaulted loans pre-COVID, we still have well over a million loans in forbearance that are government sponsored forbearance programs. And these are the worst of the worst. So if they don't get, now should be the time that these get worked out. Wouldn't you agree, Dave? What's your take on the forbearance and modification streamlining process and how you guys are doing it?
I got to tell you, with the forbearance, I think Bob said it. If I apologize, maybe it was George. We haven't seen a lot of people using the forbearance agreements over the past, post-COVID. But I will say I am pricing it into my equation for pricing moving forward. So I don't know if that answers your question or not, because I see, whatever the government does, I have to kind of reflect that on the backside from a pricing right. perspective. But fortunately, I haven't seen it being used. I've gotten a lot of phone calls about it. And I think what people don't understand about the forbearance agreements is they're still responsible for those payments. But it instead, right. so those that's going to go to the back end of the mortgage. So if you have the money, pay it, right. because nothing's really changing. So I hopefully that answers.
No, that's a very good point. I had friends. It's funny because there's a lot of friends of ours that have money that over the year. I mean, when you look at the 3.5 million people that went into forbearance and then exited, a good portion of those are people with multiple properties and certainly the means to maintain those. And they just took a couple months off from payments. And some of them have already come back and said to me, well, I shouldn't have done that. Now I can write this huge check or whatever. You make a very good point, Dave. And it's the unspoken part of the whole kicking the can down the road is you don't press a button on the back end and make those payments go away. So the people that have been sitting in these programs for a year or more, they're the worst of the worst, and they're even further and further behind. I was with a banker, again, that same conference last week with one of the general counsels at a unnamed bank, community bank from Tennessee. And she said, listen, we have study after study that says once a borrower is 90 days or more late, there's less than a 5% chance of ever recovering from that. So
Bill, that's a great what you just said is a great point, and what's going through my pricing. That's why a lot of these banks, to your point, what you just said, you know, 90 days past due, but they don't have to report that on an investor sheet if they're public right now with the forbearance agreements with the government. So banks are not currently taking the losses they need to take because of this.
That's right.
Do I believe that starts in 2022 in a big way? 1,000%. Because one of the great, Jamie Dimon from JP Morgan said it recently, JP Morgan Chase said recently, I think it was about a month ago in the Wall Street Journal, he said, listen, we have some money packed up for these forbearance agreements, but their stock hasn't reflected the losses yet. They're the biggest behemoth in the room, but all those local Tennessee banks or whoever else it is does not have that written off. And it's going to be very interesting when they have to take the write-offs, how this will affect publicly held banks in 2022. And it will happen sooner rather than later.
Very good point. And one of the things that for those that are watching that might want to do a little independent research to verify what Dave's saying, the best way to do so is just to Google TDR and CECL, C-E-C-L, reporting requirements as a result of the CARES Act. TDR is troubled debt restructuring reporting, and CECL is an accounting measure that you know, accounts for losses from non-performing debt. And both of those reporting requirements, which were instituted after the last crisis, were suspended at the time of COVID. And that suspension of those reporting requirements was extended through the December of this year. And it is another topic that the bankers were talking about last week as, you know, hey, look, you know, the party's over in terms of that regarding. Let me comment real quick on the
forbearance. I think you made a good point there. These people still have to make these payments. So they're kicking the can down the road. And to George's point earlier about the fades are coming back, everybody thinks there's so much equity in these properties. But when you start adding accrued interest and these missed payments and everything that's been accumulated during these forbearance plans, all of a sudden this 40% equity turns into 10% equity. I don't think we'll get to an underwater point like we were in 08, 09, but this cushion of equity, you know, you're looking at UPB versus BPO. We'll start looking at total legal balance due in BPO. You're going to see a lot tighter market right there. And that equity position, not on every loan, but on the majority of loans that you think have a good, you know, good equity, isn't going to be what you think it is when you start getting all that forbearance money added in, any corporate advances, accrued interest, missed payments, et cetera. Even kicking it down the road to the back end of the loan is going to eat up some of that equity.
Very well said. Very good point. And further, you know, me is like, got to verify, trust and verify. There is data to support exactly what you said, Bob. Look up Andy Walden, who is one of the economists at Black Knight, did a report on this about that. You know, while there is some great appreciation to cover some of these losses, that in the area of FHA and VA, where traditionally very high LTV loans to begin with, all of that appreciation or majority of that appreciation is useless because of the unpaid debts that are building up on total debt. Very good point to that. Well, then I guess the big question, and Nick actually asked it in our Q&A, is when does the REO market turn? When does real estate level off? And what's the prediction? How does it look? And I will start by going back to, again, the most recent data that I've gotten. I was in the last week, and I had the opportunity to listen to Doug Duncan from Fannie Mae. He's one of their chief economists, really smart guy. Spoke to us literally a week ago, Monday. And he did share some stats it basically at the end of the day was, you know, he shared some stats. I'm not going to get into the graphs now. If anybody wants the report, just email me. I'd be glad to share it. But it's right like where we were in 2006 when the market was getting so high and affordability was becoming a problem. And that's right where we're at. So I think, pointing, Bob, to what you were saying, that everyone wants to put a blanket on it. Yes, in South Florida, the market's still ridiculous and going up crazy. And, you know, in areas where, you know, I guess there's different demographics of the country are different. And so maybe there's areas of the country where we've already hit that peak of affordability. We still have very low supplies, but what is your prediction for, and this Fannie Mae economist has pointed out that the indicators are that the leveling off is already starting in certain areas because of the affordability issue. And then he also indicated the expectation that there will be some creep up in interest rates. And those two things coming together could take a very hot market with no inventory to a cooled off market where people are starting to freak out. Who wants to take their thoughts on that first?
I'll go first. So you've mentioned, Bill, a couple of times, worst of the worst, referring to some of the forbearance loans from the last couple of years. But I'd say the worst of the worst are the loans being signed today at the height of the market, paying, buying property at 120 to 130% over what those same properties were selling for a year ago, and probably 150, 160% or more than they were, at the depth of the last crisis, probably even greater than that. So I think those are the most at risk borrowers. Those are the borrowers who are buying at the peak of the market. Many of them are doing it with 3% down. Even if they can't afford it, once this market goes the other direction, and I think it will be substantial. People who, it happened last time, who are sitting in a home with a $300,000 mortgage on a property that is now worth $200,000, fast forward a couple of years, are going to say, this doesn't make sense. Even if I can afford it, it doesn't make sense. And that is where that fuels the downturn. And I think we're going to see all those elements that came back. Every time this happens, I mean, I'm old enough that I've seen this a few times, but it's the same story. And people start saying, well, this time it's different. It's not different this time. It's not going to be a small correction. It's going to be a massive correction to make up for this massive appreciation we've seen over the last decade, and especially in the last year. That's extraordinary. There's no way. I mean, every cycle, it's cliche to say the greater the rise, the greater the fall, but that's what we're in for. And you're right. It feels like 2006. There's a little more life probably on this, but at some point it turns the other way. And, the elements and the factors are different. Certainly subprime lending was very aggressive and fueled the last downturn. But this time, I mean, I think all the government intervention that we've seen over the last, say, 18 months in response to COVID have fueled and injected these artificial factors into the marketplace. But that, you pull those stilts under, this thing comes crashing down.
Right.
Yeah. And I would think, Bill, the folks that you were on at your last conference, the General Counsel of the banks, they're the ones that are going to start the selling part. They're going to tell everybody it's time to get these off of our balance sheet. We don't want the reputational risk of being the ones who foreclosed during COVID or right after the pandemic. And I think they're the ones that are going to say it's probably best that we get these off our balance sheet, whether the bank's taking the loss or not. The other thing that I always try to keep an eye on, whenever you're entering an election year, and even though it's not a presidential election year, it is a swing midterm 2022, you're going to see, well, interest rates have to go up. Well, politically, that might not be a great play for one party or the other, and that may or may not happen. So I don't know. Are they going to help, George mentioned some of the government intervention that we have, not only with, stimulus checks and, stuff for borrowers, rental assistance, which they still can't, distribute. It's kind of like hardest hit funds 2.0. They got money, but they can't give it away. But I just think you have the political environment plays a role in that. And that's why I think funds, especially you guys that are larger funds than we are, we'll get, a tranche from you guys. But we're going to get those assets because the bigger boys don't want to deal with that reputational risk and be the ones on the front page of the paper or having to deal with CFPB or the administration or why are you pursuing foreclosure and so forth as opposed to, workouts and stuff. So I don't think they want to be in the spotlight, so to speak. And I think that's where we're going to see the opportunity. So I don't know, second quarter of next year, it should be really interesting.
Yeah, totally. No. To follow up with to confirm what you just said, Bob, I actually was surprised to hear an exec, a senior VP in the SAG division at a major, one of the largest banks in this country, tell me that they rarely ever, that their intention is not to take anything back REO, that they really do, when they see no end to other than foreclosure, they will exit via note sale. I'm not going to tell you who, because I'm going to go pursue those deals. I'll sell you some of you. Dave, what are your thoughts? Talk to me about your thoughts on when this market will turn. Then we got one or two more questions. Because we started late, with the audience's permission, and you guys, if you guys don't mind, I'd like to go like an extra 5 minutes, if that works for each of you.
I can give you three. Three and a half tops.
Great. Thanks, Dave. So generous.
You're on the clock. So my thoughts. I think first quarter to second quarter of next year is kind of the right timing. I agree with that. And it's all based off of when this forbearance agreement ends. The forbearance is really interesting. It's a double-edged sword. It affects businesses and individuals. I think it's almost monotonous, but it is what it is. But what I mean by a double-edged sword is, at the same time, price appreciation is not going to last forever. Bill, you mentioned just the Florida market, but we're across the board now. During COVID, for the first month or two, everybody thought everybody's moving to Florida from New York. But now prices have skyrocketed again in New York. So they've gone back to normal levels. But people are still moving to Florida, to that point. But California, Colorado, Nevada, it ain't stopping anywhere right now. This is the price appreciation, I think, is going to stop when interest rates start to climb, which I believe will be the beginning part of next year, because that will affect securitization market, bank lending rates, et cetera, from an institutional point of view. So I think the beginning of next year, there'll be more opportunities, but it's also a matter of getting the banks in line with what's realistic and not. And when they have to start taking losses, real losses, is when that pricing is going to come into effect.
Well, and yeah, no, all very good. That's a very good point. And, to that end, what I'm hearing from each of you is the rollout will be via the secondary market starting in the early part of next year. So the average investor or the smaller investor might not be looking at real opportunities until the second half. The other thing that I would also predict to happen is, if we have 1.5 million homeowners that are severely delinquent, some portion of those people, once their forbearance is over, or maybe their forbearances are already over and they are now sitting out that last 90 day through the end of this year that CFPB has provided as guidance recommendations to the servicers, loss mit period, which I think that we could also see a large increase in borrowers looking to exit with whatever equity we have. And that could be one of the things that turns the market in the early portion of next year. That way, that even if interest rates don't go up, because Bob makes a good point, it's a midterm election year. Maybe it's not until, maybe there's a 50 basis point over the course of the year or something like that, but any major rate increase might be a 2023. But certainly all of those factors are coming together. There is one question that I stepped over that I want to just quickly run to George or anyone else. Is anyone using MLOs, licensed loan officers on the ground in various states to help you with your streamlining process, or are you running it all through the servicer? George?
Yeah, so we are a servicer and an originator. So we have a team of MLOs licensed in almost all states, and they do their mods. They also, ideally, if they can find borrowers who are qualified for refinancing, that's ideal. I mean, they could take them from their 6 or 7% loan into a 3% loan. When they qualify, that's ideal. But if they don't, then they're the ones that are handling the modifications. And that's typically, there's some states that require that an MLO handles all the mod negotiations, not all states.
Okay, great. Bob, what about you?
Yeah, I mean, we work it through our servicer. Most of our mods are done by our MLOs. I got to get on that refi thing, though, because we're not getting enough of those, George. I think that's a great strategy. And Yeah, that's good.
Yep, we can do that for you. We'll solicit your portfolio if you like for mods. For refinancing. And we especially do this with some groups that own a lot of land contracts, which generally are not, you know, oftentimes the documentation isn't that compliant. A lot of buyers won't buy land contracts as a result, especially institutional buyers. Right. But if you can take a mod, if you can take a land contract and modify that, take a land contract and refinance that, even if you're simply doing it onto your docs, you're going to pick up 5 or 10 points in value right away, because now it's a mortgage versus a land contract. And ideally, you know, 1 in 5, 1 in 10, hey, they qualify to go, you know, for Freddie, Fannie, FHA, VA loan, and you get paid off in full. So those are things that that we're doing right now for several funds and we can continue to do.
Brilliant. Okay, well, I really appreciate the time. The last thing we do, it's our win-win tradition here, is to leave us with your predictions. It could be your prediction for the rest of this year. It could be your prediction for next year. It could be very serious, like, hey, you know, the market's going to turn first quarter. Or it could be something funny like, you know, I don't know. I can't even think of anything funny right now. George, let's start with you. Predictions for the next 3 to 12 months.
Yeah, I think 3 to 12 months, at some point we start seeing the other side of this in that time frame, in all likelihood. I think it is in that probably 6 to 12 month time frame. I mean, if you want something funny, the funny thing is that the really super bright minds in our country, financial minds, who I think are overpaying for assets today. And I mean, granted, they have super cheap leverage. They can justify it, but they are paying extraordinary prices. And this is typically fueled by Wall Street and big institutions. And if they're going to be, I mean, I can't imagine in 6 or 12 months, somebody's not going to be saying, wait, you know, why'd we do that? We did this in the subprime era. There were analysts who were saying, hey, this is all going to work. And in the end, it just all collapsed. I think there's a lot of people thinking the same thing. In fairness, a lot of those, when we sell a pool of loans, lots of times it's being, as David mentioned, it's eventually being securitized, but somebody's money is going up for this. Right. And whoever is underwriting those securitizations, somebody's got to be saying, wait, you know, this is, everybody else is doing it, but it's, that doesn't justify it. Still, in my mind, doesn't make sense. Just like home buyers paying, you know, multiple offers, paying top of the market today is a really tough, And I think we've seen this before. It was 2006, 2007, very similar situation. And it all came crashing down. I think we're right on the doorstep, the altar of this thing, collapsing. Right. Again, I don't think it's imminent, but it's in the future. You can probably see a little bit of the dust cloud starting to kick up.
I agree. I do everything I can. You know, things are crazy when like your gardener is starting to ask you what if he should buy a house, and you know, I've got all my nieces and nephews and my son. They're all like, we got to get a house. And I'm like, just calm down. The interest rates are not going to go up that significantly a year from now. The world might look much different. Dave Gordon, what's your prediction?
Real quick, even if they're not just buying it, the worst is when the gardener's not just buying a house, he's like flipping three houses. Flipping it, right. That's even scarier.
He can't afford to buy the parts for his lawnmower, but he can he owns 4 or 5 houses. That's a problem. Mm-hmm. All thanks to Civic. No, we won't say that. Dave Gordon, what are your predictions for the future?
I got to say, I'm a little agnostic, different than what you guys are saying. I believe that prices are coming down, but I think the deviation is only going to be 5 or 10%. And when you're talking about home buyers specifically, if in 2 years interest rates rise 2%, you know, that's going to make a significant, yes, when interest rate climbs, obviously at the same time, prices are going to decrease a little bit. Right. So I do think that's going to happen. But when you compare where people are moving from, let's use New York, California to, I don't know, Florida, North Carolina, et cetera, the pricing is down. You're seeing the appreciation in those states specifically because, you know, in 2000, I think it was George who said it, but, you know, use 2006, for example. But in 2006, we didn't have remote workers. We were all working on a trading desk and financing. Remote working has been proven via COVID. With that in mind, you're seeing major price appreciation from places like Tennessee, Washington, Texas, North Carolina, places where you've never seen price appreciation before, because when people are paying 1,000 a square foot, 2,000 a square foot in New York, They were 2 years ago able to buy it $300 a square foot in North Carolina, and all of a sudden it still looks cheap at $500 a square foot.
Right.
So does that continue? People are working remotely. There's proof of concept for that. So it's going to continue in that direction.
So yeah, and what I'm hearing you say, and that's another thing, by the way, you know, there's no right or wrong answers here. Another thing is there's a new normal in real estate, right? And especially in the residential real estate market. We have redefined what residential real estate means because it's no longer our home. It's also where we've like confined ourselves for 18 months and we're working. So very good point and very good possible prediction. Bob, you get the last shot. Talk to me about what your prediction is.
All right, well, I'm going to go off track just a little bit. For 23 years, I've had season tickets for the Dallas Cowboys, and I predict that finally we will be back at the Super Bowl.
I love it.
So, okay. So go ahead. I didn't say win it. I just said we'll be back at it.
So bring Emmitt Smith and Troy Aikman back.
That's great stuff. That is really awesome. Well, gentlemen, I also
predict that everybody who wants to learn more about the MPL space will be at Node Expo November 5th and 6th.
That's right. I was going to get
George, David, love to have you guys come out there. Bill, I know you'll be there. So we're 3 weeks away, November 5th and 6th, Node Expo.
Yeah, that's right. Node Expo in Dallas, in person, Friday and Saturday, November 5th and 6th. George Newbery, check out Pre-REO if you're looking to get deals. A very interesting program to give access to individual investors to buy NPL. And Dave Gordon and I are always available to answer questions. Guys, it's been great spending an hour with you. We got to do it more often. We'll see you sometime. See you all around.
Always a pleasure, guys.
Thanks.
Thanks, everyone. All right, bye. Bye-bye.